Good morning, everybody. It's Matt Kinsman, Head of Content at Connectiv. Welcome to the Digital Media Council meeting. As I said, we've had terrific response to this topic on building a better digital ops structure, and I'm hoping you guys will really join in the conversation today. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our chair, Roberta Muller.
Hi, everybody. 80 people. Woo! I think that's a world record for us at Connectiv DMC meeting, so I'm glad everybody can join. So let's flip the slide there, Matt. So our agenda today is, the main core of our agenda is going to be looking at digital operations workflow. For those of you out there that may be like North Star, we are literally drowning in work sometimes between ads being served and emails, newsletters, you know, new product development, et cetera. So we've been taking a long, hard look at our digital operations team and our structure. So we're going to touch on that today. I think first, though, let's talk a little bit about some maybe digital trends. You want to flip that slide? So I was reading an article on, 2019 upcoming innovations that help digital media, technology, and data to help companies support their digital transformation. We talk about that a lot here at North Star, is digital transformation. And there was 2 points that kind of resonated with me. One was the discussion around mobile speed. It's interesting. We know it used to be the big thing was, you know, your websites needed to be, you know, web optimized. And that's kind of passe now, right? That's old. Today now it's all about technologies like AMP pages, accelerated mobile pages. And I know that Google, you know, when Google speaks, everybody listens. I know Google was proclaiming that it's very important to make sure your download speed, you know, the speed at which your pages are loading on your mobile phone are really tight. And they announced, I think it was back in July, that they were going to be adding the page speed to factor in your mobile ranking. So we started looking at that here, and building of AMP pages is on our list of things to do. So it might be something you guys might want to also jot down if you haven't done so already. I found that when I was reading the article, they said that 53% of mobile site visitors leave the page if it doesn't load in 3 seconds. And I had to chuckle at that because I'm on my phone and I think it's even less than 3 seconds. If something doesn't load, I'm on, I'm off. Standard web pages, they did some research. Standard web pages on mobile average 6.43% for load time, which is just like, oh my God, it sounds like an eternity, right? AMP pages, which we've been looking at, are averaging around 1.54 seconds being loaded. So if you, I put a little chart up there for you. You know, the longer it takes your page to load, the more people are bouncing off and onto something else. So I thought that was a good chart to kind of keep in your eyesight as you move forward into 2019, if you haven't done so already. The other interesting thing I saw in the article was it was digital transformation kind of around innovative ways to personalize content for your user, your end users, using images. And, you know, I know this looks like it's a consumer one, right? They're talking about it was a clothing store. But if you, you know, if you think about it, we went through a whole audience exercise of bucketing our audience into personas, right? We created personas for planners, meeting planners. We created personas for travel agents. And, you know, when I was looking at and reading the article, I was thinking to myself, well, there really is no reason why we can't, you know, do something more visual on our websites to offer content up to people in more of a visually selected way, right? So, you know, we've got travel agents who definitely, you know, they're into cruise. They book a lot of cruise, or they're dedicated to cruise. So there's no reason why we can't probably start to think about driving user experience and driving content recommendations in a little bit more of a visual way. So I think that was that one resonated with me as well. Kind of taking the conversation on your website with the use of images. And then the article went on to talk a little bit about chatbots that hasn't gone away at all, and voice-based browsing, which we put on our list of things to do to explore a little bit in 2019. So two topics, two trends for 2019, just to kind of keep on your radar. And with that, we can jump into our next topic. We want to flip the slide, digital operations. You can flip the slide again. All right, so I feel like Lucille Ball sometimes when I sit down in front of the sales team when I go to sales meetings and I talk about some of the snafus that come up during digital production. You know, sometimes ads don't get served. Sometimes emails don't go out on time. Sometimes the email goes out and there's nothing in the subject line. You know, stuff happens. And as our business has changed, where we're no longer selling just basic banner ads. Now we're selling really large integrated media packages, which have tons of different reporting attached to it. Right? It's social and leads and banner ads and newsletters and engagement metrics and content. You know, there's a lot that goes into some of the packages that the salespeople sell right now. And our workflow was such that we have a centralized team. So we have a team of a very small team, lean and mean, and they handle anything that has to do with digital, right? There's people on the team that serve ads, but at the same time, they may swivel their chair around and they may actually, you know, work on newsletters. And someone might be working on email and banner ads being served, and someone might work on, you know, custom content and native ads. It's a hodgepodge within the team, and we find it really hard to hire people because we've cross-trained everybody, and you can't actually get somebody out there who just knows every form of digital platform. So it's kind of been a little bit of a challenge for us, and we started to really see some hiccups in the process of trying to make sure we deliver everything correctly. So if you flip to the next slide, I took a few months listening to the pain points throughout the business, right? So a lot of it came from the salespeople, and God loves salespeople. You know, they've got something to say about everything, and it's never their fault. I love them dearly. As I started to listen to people's pain points, not only in sales, but also in our own production team and over in order entry and in finance and, you know, over in the team that just tries to collect material, which is a daunting task in itself, I started to bucket those complaints into categories. And we mapped out the workflow, right, from when an order comes in to when it finally gets delivered. And we then overlaid the pain points onto the workflow. And we found that the largest portion of complaints primarily had to do with productization. And I wouldn't have thought of that when I first started. Sometimes I thought it was just sheer communication, and I thought maybe it was lack of training for everybody, but it was a little bit deeper than that. You know, revenue recognition was an instant. I mean, we actually had salespeople dictating when revenue would be recognized, and I was like, okay, yeah, that just doesn't need to happen. You know, we looked at how long it took us to solve a problem. When a client had a problem or when somebody noticed there was an issue, say on a website or with something in email, it would take us days to stop what we were doing to figure that out. And some of it was training. Some of it was the definition of what's supposed to be in the product to begin with. I mean, we have salespeople who are selling stuff, and to be honest with you, sometimes they don't really understand what it is they're selling. So we had a lot of issues that we went through, and we tried our best to figure out kind of what category do they fall in, and then where during the process do they fall. And from there, we started to, let's flip the slide over, we started to look at how many people does the client have to work with. And when I actually sat down and actually sat with the print production team at all, because, You know, everybody wanted, there's too many people in digital production. You've got people who do email, and people if there's a newsletter, people if there's an ad series. Like, there's a lot of people involved in digital, and print only has one person. And I found that actually wasn't even true. Even with print ads being sold, there's someone who does the run-a-site pages in the book, right? There's the main issue. There's people who handle supplements and guides and cover wraps. And it's just, it got to be like a web that I started to build. And from here, we actually mapped out that the client may talk to a salesperson, and they may talk to the sales support person. But after that, once that sale comes through, oh my God, there's like 32 people that a client can actually talk to at North Star for one order. And the big takeaway with that is that, you know what, it's not easy to do business with us. And that was a really large complaint that we were hearing from clients and even from salespeople, that it's just too darn hard. So if any of this is resonating with you guys out there on the phone today, I think this is a great topic for us to explore. So we hired, Reggie Hudson is on the phone with us today. So I hired Reggie as digital operations director, specifically looked at his resume where he's been at much larger companies, some for B2C. And so he had a really great background in digital operations. And so I'm going to turn the meeting over now to Reggie, if you want to unmute yourself with *7, and have him talk a little bit about what we're calling the pod structure, which I think will probably be similar to some of you, but it's what we're doing here at North Star, and we'll get the ball rolling. So if anybody's got any questions right now and you want to unmute yourself, feel free. Other than that, we'll turn it over to Reggie. And you can flip the slide, too.
Thank you, Roberta. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yep.
Awesome. So, yes, we have a lot of pain points, and we've been tasked with trying to work through that to streamline it a little bit better for our external clients, advertisers and agencies, and our internal clients, the sales side of the business, which brings us to the pod structure, which you see in front of you now, where we're transitioning to be able to craft a team that aligns to a specific salesperson. There's small groups that basically have individuals with complementary skill sets that will help to see an order through and empowering the team members by increasing efficiency, fostering a better sense of collaboration and communication, which I'm sure is a big issue for everyone, holding specific people accountable within a process, and allowing team members to be innovative within that process, which ultimately provides more value for our clients. And if you're kind of recapping the slide, the previous slide where Roberta alluded to there being 32 touch points within a process, this will kind of give responsibility to one specific client-facing person and then one specific non-client-facing person to kind of be the liaisons between the whole workflow structure and hopefully streamline this entire process. If you could switch to the next slide. So we've identified four areas within the digital order flow that should hopefully bring us through the full life of an IO. There's the order creation phase where your salesperson is coming up with ideas with a client. We're trying to understand what their KPIs are and ultimately offering up of products to execute on their goals. Our order auditing phase where there's a system of checks and balances in place where we internally can make sure that what the salesperson has gone out the door with, we can actually execute on. Once we pass through that phase, there's the implementation and delivery phase where we're actually doing what we said we're going to do. And hopefully, if all of that goes off without a hitch, it brings us to the invoicing stage where billing is able to send off any invoices. So what we've done is kind of realigned our group to, instead of working here at North Star, we work based off of business units. So we have our retail group, our corporate group, and our meetings groups. And currently, we have people that are aligned to those specific business units, but no rhyme or reason in terms of how an order would come in. So to be a little more strategic, we're now going to align to a specific salesperson. So our salesperson's role will not change. They'll continue to have those conversations and not necessarily be involved with the day-to-day of client interfacing, but the initial conversation. Sales support is that support person that keeps the salesperson on the road, having those conversations, and they're really just making sure that the order is entered and everyone that is on the back end has all the details that they need to be able to fully execute. Now we're creating a new role internally, an account management role, which will be client-facing. This will be a person that has a solid understanding of our digital business, not as technically involved with the campaigns or analytically involved with the campaigns, but really the person that can handhold the client, make sure that you know their needs are being met, and that they understand that we're trying to provide true value to working with us. On the right side of this line is where our pod structure really starts to work, where we have a campaign manager. This is also a relatively new role here at North Star. Orders traditionally have come in and someone sets it and forgets it pretty much. There's no analysis, no optimizations, no suggestions provided on how we can improve performance. There may have been some people within the company that have done that, but now we're trying to streamline it and create one designated role that gives us the opportunity to provide more insights and analysis of campaigns on a regular basis, and it's coming from one person consistently. These two are kind of the most pivotal roles within this whole pod structure. The account manager and the campaign manager should be in constant contact with each other, having weekly pacing meetings, conversations about delivery, and making sure that we're ultimately executing on everything that was on that insertion order. The campaign manager on our end, because we have so many different types of products, will also be a team lead of sorts for the back-end side. So in reference to digital display, we currently outsource all of our ad trafficking. So they'll be the person that's having the communication on creative QA with the trafficking team, making sure general reporting is set up, screenshots, and anything that would run across all of our sites, the campaign manager would have that communication with the ad trafficker. Third-party e-blasts and dedicated e-blasts is a large part of our business, so we'll have a dedicated resource team there where if an order were to come in, the campaign manager would alert the team and make sure that they see it through. We also have a large product or large offering of e-newsletters, and the same for social. So the campaign manager being the primary liaison between everything on the right side of this line, non-client facing, just kind of leading the team and seeing all the different elements of an IO through to billing. And the account manager is really the team lead on the client facing side to make sure that whatever the salesperson is selling and whatever vernacular is being used in the marketplace, it's adequately interpreted on the back end so that we can make sure all of our systems are talking properly and will hopefully get us to the billing stage where we're all on the same page. If you can flip to the next slide.
Can you, Rob, before we jump to the next slide, we had a couple questions come in on this one. One, is the account manager used for all clients or only the large ones?
It's a great question. I think it depends on what your scale looks like. We internally, we have a very small team, so we're in talks about different tiers of offerings. So, yes, an account manager would be on a larger program, maybe even a mid-level tier program. And in all actuality, an account manager should probably be on every account, but it's the level of effort that's being given from that person that is determined by the tier. So you may see a campaign manager take more of the lead on a lower tier program, just based on what your scalability is internally.
Mm-hmm. This is Roberta. I would also add that if you, so because I forgot to add it to the chart, but if you draw a circle around from the account manager all the way around to the purple into the banner ad traffickers, that essentially becomes your pod, right? It's your account manager forward facing all the way back to your delivery team. So that's what we're calling a pod. And like Reggie said, you know, orders are going to come in for just, you know, for banner ads or for emails. And, you know, they're going to come through the process the same way. The account manager probably won't look at those, right, because they're just traditional media that kind of doesn't need to be bundled into a big package. But some of those larger programs that we have that might be 50,000 or up, 60,000, and we've got some programs that are $250,000, they definitely need somebody to, an account manager type person to kind of keep all of that running smoothly. So the pod is from the account manager back to the delivery team.
I can even take that a step further, and I've seen in some instances where a billing analyst might even be considered in a pod as well. Mm-hmm. Again, that just depends on if you have the ability to have a dedicated resource, whether it's you know, aligning to a specific salesperson, sales group, a region. All depends on how your company is set up.
All right, good. And Rob, one more question on this slide. Who do you outsource with, and is this the first outsource partner you've worked with?
So we outsource with a company called DCT, Digital Convergence. Is it, Roberta?
Yeah,
would you?
Yeah, okay. Digital Convergence Technology.
Right. So they are basically handling general responsibilities of ad trafficking, so creative QA, making sure that ad tags or ad creative is in the right format. They're going to run it through ad validation for us to make sure there's no errant pixels, make sure everything is firing, make sure HTML creative is put together properly. And then even further down, I think where they're really going to start helping us out is from a reporting standpoint. We want to be able to start spitting out reports on a more frequent basis, more consistent basis, and they'll be able to automate most of that, right? Like when an order is starting, they can set up an automation or also help us put it into a dashboard, and that in turn gives our campaign manager the time to be able to analyze and come up with suggestions on performance, compare based off of benchmarks, and you know, we think that there will be some true value there to be able to provide back to a client and hopefully generate more revenue.
Right.
All right.
Any other questions?
Thanks.
Oh, okay, great. So we could flip to the next slide.
So this is a more detailed view of how we're looking at what those roles and responsibilities are. I'm sorry because the chart is very big and it's kind of scaled down here, so apologies right now for the small font. But basically we've broken out the different sales life cycles. So this is essentially the life of an IO, from ideation to reconciliation. All of the colors that you see in this tab will determine if a person is responsible, accountable, in a support capacity, should they be consulted just for general awareness, and informed as well, which is very similar. The top roles on the right-hand side stand for account executive, sales support. At North Star, we have an order entry team that is actually inputting orders into our systems. Then you get into what we started to talk about in the pod structure with account manager, campaign manager, email manager, social media, ad trafficker, and then lastly, it's our billing analyst. So each of those people have some sort of responsibility within one of these phases, whether it's pre-sales, IO validation, order audit, actually booking your IO and making sure that we have all necessary approvals so that our client is fully aware of what we're going to execute on, and every role and responsibility or every department internally has a full understanding of what that is as well. Then you start to actually get into the campaign launch and monitoring delivery, monitoring performance, optimizations, and reconciliation, and a majority of that falls on your ad ops team, where your campaign manager is going to lead the charge and starting to aggregate reporting and analyzing its performance. Next slide. So there are several benefits of a pod. For a client, it's reduction in the number of touch points. And by client, I say a client for us is external, being an advertiser and an agency, but also internal. Sales should be considered your client because you're working to try to be able to execute something that they've worked hard to be able to put in front of us. Sales has a single go-to person for information. That's, again, streamlining communication. Right now at North Star, I think one of the biggest pain points that Roberta had alluded to earlier is that, you know, internally we have too many people that are kind of just trying to take it on and get things done, which is great. It's you know, an all-hands-on-deck approach, but sometimes that can create a lot of confusion, and we want to be able to limit that and have specific people accountable for certain responsibilities. When you have a smaller team, scale is an issue, and when everybody is all hands on deck, there's no real understanding of how you can manage multiple orders. So hopefully this gives more transparency to the availability of bandwidth internally, and will make a small team be able to scale a little bit more than what an all hands on deck approach will. And most importantly, it's accountability. When there is an all hands on deck approach, you don't necessarily have one person to go to make sure that something was done. Now in a streamlined process using a pod structure, everyone has specific roles that they have to manage within that process, and we can easily identify you know, where something is hung up or who is the go-to person to get answers for us to help push this through. So great. That's the approach that we're taking, and hopefully if you guys are looking into using a pod structure, hopefully this will be a little bit beneficial to you.
I think we should come back next year and see how we've progressed. So we've got a couple other people I know that have joined today from Farm Journal and Advertising Specialty Institute. So, you know, if maybe James or Arnold or maybe Bernadette, if you guys want to chime in at all about maybe what you've got going on at your respective companies in your operations side, that would be great, a little bit more insight.
Sure. We've actually got this set up. So Justin's going to be talking about some of the workflow tools that his team is using. And then James and Bernadette are going to offer us some quick hits on the ad ops improvements that they've made in their organizations. I just want to get to one quick question before we jump over to Justin for Roberta or for Rob. The question is, where do the pods report into?
That's a good question. So if you go back two slides. So what we're actually doing is looking at our marketing solutions or marketing services team, who primarily handle a lot of our large customers. So the account managers are going to now roll up and into marketing services, marketing solutions, and be forward facing to the client, because that's really where their skill set sits. And then the account managers all the way through to delivery, that will all roll under Reggie Hudson, who was speaking previously. So that's kind of how we split the two groups out.
All right, great. Thank you. Any other questions before we move to Justin? All right. Justin, take it away. I've unmuted your line.
Awesome. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yep. Okay, so I thought this would be a really nice part two to the conversation. You know, I think obviously Roberta and Rob touched on some really good points and some really critical ones too, right, when it comes to efficiently having people work in that pod format and come through with a workflow that works for everybody in terms of getting a process that streamlines, you know, getting something that's a well-oiled machine and cranking through work. And if you don't mind jumping ahead a slide, Matt, just to jump right into it. What I'm going to talk about today is a little bit of, you know, that workflow overview when it comes to technology. Because for me, it's great. I, as a technology person, I work with all ends of our business here at Strategic Insight, our sales teams, our marketing teams, and all the groups that have different processes that they're working through. And it's usually, you know, on my end of the table to come up with some technology solution that will work as a backbone to these processes, because it's great when you put them down on paper, but putting them to practical use sometimes breaks down if you don't have the right flow internally to keep everyone working in this format. I think it's, you know, the easiest thing in any business for people to kind of just do what they do every day and wake up and come to work and follow your routine. And sometimes having a change in process is really the hardest thing to do. So what I'm going to talk about is really some ways to use tools to define and help reinforce some of these things that we've just talked about. So obviously many teams use a lot of different tools when it comes to, you know, tracking and project management tools and process tools, things like Jira, OnTime, Rally, Trello. And you know, these are all really great engines, and I think I'm going to gear my conversation just agnostic of which tool you're using. Personally, we use Jira here at Strategic Insight to track all of our tools and track all of our workflows, which extend well past our technology team, which is what I want to talk about here today. So having a customizable workflow engine to allow, you know, your business to adapt is really important. It can obviously work to adapt all kinds of company cultures, whether you're small and a startup company or you're a large enterprise organization. You know, you want to have tools in place to help your team change culture and really redefine processes. So as an organization grows, develops a unique culture, right, based on how your employees work together in groups and in teams or in pods, and how the team functions is obviously reflected in the workflow that you've defined for them here. So you know, the goal, as always, for me is going to be coming up with a repeatable process that makes it easier for people to work together at scale. And I think that's the important thing, is sometimes finding a process that works and putting it into practical use is harder, you know, to do, never easier said than done when it comes to defining on paper the way people should work together and kind of telling everyone to go. You know, in my opinion, it's a lot like trying on 6 pairs of shoes, right, until you find the perfect fit, and taking time to customize the workflow, you know, as you need it to, it'll obviously pay off down the line. So what I'm going to do is walk through a few concepts and lay out some best practices for people when you're trying to define this and then put it into practical use. So jump ahead, Matt. So let's start with, you know, defining the workflow. I think in the examples Roberta and Rob just showed us, we had some really nice workflows and how that should conceptually work. You know, so for me, the best way to come up with the right workflow for your team is really to find the best way to measure things, right? From the data side, data is key to everything. So having a defined process is great, but unless you have a method to judge your current process against your old process, it's really hard to produce a metric to show that you're working better or smarter or more efficient than before, other than having better sales numbers. Right, so the single biggest benefit for me of a workflow that's customized for a specific team is that you can quantify and track how people work together. Like with all things agile, you know, use where you are as the current base point, defining those key metrics that you want to measure and track, and make those changes you need iteratively. Because, you know, in my practice, putting the workflow down on paper and putting it down on practical use sometimes changes as you start to put it and try it. You know, even that model we had up before where we're talking about the way we want account managers to work with the rest of the team and where you want the rest of the team to have those touch points. Sometimes when you put it to practical use, it just doesn't happen that way. So jump ahead, Matt. So finding the right workflow, a couple of pitfalls I think that, you know, are really important to talk about, especially when it comes to tools that are going to help guide this process, which is that a lot of these tools just have, you know, hundreds of configurations, you know, a lot of fields and things. Where do you start with this stuff? A lot of tools have base templates that are really super generic for business teams. you know, I always like to hear the story of, you know, we're trying to get our marketing teams to use Jira. So we got them Jira, and that's it. Like, we're hoping it just kind of happens, right? Like, they're using Jira, so it should just happen like everyone else. You know, the key for me is you always want to stay focused on the work, not the value, right? It's always about the value returned. And one of the key pitfalls I always see, and this one came up this week, I think I was talking to Lydia and someone else on an off conversation, but coming up with cross-team analytics, these are really important things to think about when you're starting to define how that ideal workflow should work. So jump ahead, Matt. So I'm going to start with a really simple example, right, of a basic workflow when it comes to putting that into a tool format, because I think regardless of what tool you're using, whether it's Jira or Rally or OnTime, there's a lot of these tools out there and project management tools. For me, every workflow has three unique elements that are really important when you're putting this into practical use. You know, and so I'm going to use my library example, which I like when I'm teaching people Jira, of how this is supposed to work. So in the example below, we've created a workflow which sometimes it has a nice side-by-side step where you're going from left to right on your board, or in the example before with the account manager screen, we have specific people that are supposed to get involved in this process. But I think this is a really nice example of when you're bringing this into a technology and you want it to reinforce this process, you really have to understand, you know, the key things of what builds a workflow when it comes to technology. So there's three unique elements for me, right? These statuses, transitions, notifications. So in the example below, we have three statuses, right? In my example here, we have the process of a book in a library, right? So the status here for me, if I was building this out for someone on a board or some tool like Trello or something, there's three statuses, three columns I'd want to see when I'm tracking this work, right, without overcomplicating it. I'm either, this book is either at the library, the book is retired, or the book is out with a customer. That's it. Right? I don't need to have a million steps in between, because anything that happens in between is really a transition of this process. Right? This process is changing from A to B, or something's happening. Where if this is a typical book, right, I would have either this book be checked out or checked in with a customer, very simple. Right? Or this book is basically in service, or it's not in service. And this kind of defines the way I'm telling people that they have to work together, right? Because now I'm actually defining the rules of engagement here when it comes to a task being called complete or not, right? It has to follow through this very specific flow. So I think this is really important to understand when you're using technology, because you don't want to overcomplicate or deviate from what you've worked hard to create in your nice workflow of the way people should work together. And I think the third one that's important is notifications, because all of these tools out there, again, whether you have Rally or OnTime, they all have these three basic elements in there. And notifications is really important, because in that process you've defined earlier, at what points do people get emailed, right? Is there a specific point in that process where you expect people to talk to each other? Or is it all just kind of loosey-goosey and everyone just kind of wings it differently? Personally, I like to dictate these things of when it should happen. If I could build a technology solution to support it, that's what we'll aim to do. And we'll have very key points in this process where not only the transition changes from person to person or role to role or group to group, but we're also going to have very specific points that notify people, keeping everyone aware of where this process is at, right? Maybe I want to notify my salesperson of something that happened, right? Deal closed, right? Salesforce is another good example of you have very specific notifications that go out at certain times, and this is really important to lay out beforehand. So jump ahead, Matt. So before I look at some specific examples, I'm going to go into just some basic examples here of using these tools, right? If you want to keep these things simple, if when it comes time to build new processes around a set of people and identifying all the stakeholders at the workflow you have here, you want to make sure you have one representative from each group that's helping out in this process. You know, I think Roberta's example was really good of, you know, she got people together, you kind of defined how we think people should work. You kind of draw it out on a whiteboard, or you put it down in a PowerPoint or wherever you put together your outline. But it's really important because this process you're defining is really telling everyone what you're going to do every day when you come to work. Right? You're going to say, hey, we have a new set of rules for you guys, the way you work together and the way we want to get this done. And sometimes these things are really touchy. You know, for me personally, I always find it's obvious people like to overcomplicate these things, or they try to make more steps than they need to. Not that people are trying to make it seem like they're busy or anything like that, but I think it really comes down to making it as simple, as streamlined as possible without adding in as much extra steps as needed. And I like the right side example of, you know, really simple examples of workflows. So if you really don't need anything more sometimes than a task being completed and a task being done, right? You set it up and it's completed. Or you go a little bit farther with project management and you say, hey, actually I want to show people when the work was created, but when it's also in progress and then when you're done. Or a very different kind of process where you have many steps in between, a lot of touch points with different stakeholders, things being reviewed and constantly moving down that conveyor belt. You know, I think all of this really aligns to sort of the agile best practices in general. But for people, you know, trying to define these workflows, I think it's really important to think about what you've done as you've started to lay this out and how people are really going to put this into, you know, into your work culture. So let's look at a few examples here. Matt, do you mind going ahead one? And I'm going to start with one of our I have one more slide here, right? So I have some real-world examples that I took out of our company here of when we did the same exercise of trying to come up with a process for people and putting it down just on a whiteboard. You know, I think a really good example of things and of somewhere where you want to insert an extra step in your process is we have a design review process where we have an important part here of our creative process where you put in a creative asset through design review, right? Very simple. So Jane, our design team manager, wants to add a specific status called design review so it's clear to her team which issues are under active development and which issues are awaiting review. For me, this is perfect, right? A very clear designation and step, right? Reviewing your design layout is distinctly different than creating the design, so it makes sense to add two steps to that process, right? Pretty straightforward. But I think a good bad example of this, which sometimes people like to sneak in, and I'm not picking out marketing over design by any means, but Bill, our marketing manager, wants to add a new status called failed verification for all the issues that don't pass review by the marketing team. Now, when I see things like this come up, I would immediately advise against doing this because the marketing team can simply send that issue back to a different state, right? In this example here, like an in-progress state. But we don't want to add more steps and more labels to these things, right? I want to keep it as very simple as possible without convoluting it too far. I don't need to know that it failed verification. I just need to know that you moved it back and it's not completed at this point, right? So there's, for me, good examples of where you want to have an extra step in your process and a bad example of something that's really just making it a little more convoluted for people to understand and unsimplifying something that needs to be very simple. You want to skip ahead one more, Matt? So I'm going to start with our most complicated example, which is in technology, because this is usually an area where it has a lot of steps. And this is actually our Jira workflow here. So I took this right out of Jira, our workflow builder, where you can kind of connect our steps with arrows. And you know, for people who are familiar with the workflow builder tool, it kind of looks like this, where we built in many, many steps for our technology team, which is pretty standard for me. We don't have a very out of standard kind of process for our developers, right? Where usually this is a process where you're going to see a lot of steps of things going through QA, being promoted to different environments, development calls complete, doing some user acceptance testing, right? There's a lot of blocked tasks. So this is pretty complicated. You know, there's a lot of steps in this process, but it becomes a well-oiled machine over time for the developers that are used to working in this fashion, and there's a lot of checks and balances with some of these tasks. Go ahead, another one, Matt. So here's our workflow for our HR team. Now, I received a lot of questions beforehand about tools like Rally and OnTime and Jira, and which are predominantly used for production and development teams. But here at Strategic Insight, we use Jira for all of our business units, including sales, marketing, design, and human resources. And this is the workflow right here that our HR team follows when they onboard people. We actually have a Jira project dedicated to HR. This is where they track all of their candidates as they're being interviewed and when they get accepted. And we have workflows for every single business unit within our company, within our application here, so that we can build a board that we can share with people so people know where projects are at. And this is a well-oiled machine. It's really nice to have these things defined so that when we hire new people, I can show them things like this and say, look, these are our defined processes. These are the steps you're going to follow as you start to onboard people. You're going to go through a process where you create an internal employee profile, right? We have internal specific things that are just for us where we set up computers, we request supplies, and we track this all the way through the employee showing up on our first day and before, you know, anything happens, and we have a nice trail for every single employee that's worked here of when they accepted their offer and what happened with human resources, you know, throughout their time before they were hired. And we do all this today with Jira, right? So really nice version of using something non-Jira-centric, but that we choose to put in Jira. That way we have all our business units working in one spot. I don't need extra tools out there to track things. It obviously saves us a lot of money and cost because we don't use as many third-party tools. We want everyone to stay in the few tools that we have, and we can share data and share reports in that fashion. So let's look at one more. Jump ahead one more, Matt. So our editorial team uses Jira, which I think a lot of teams are surprised when I bring this up sometimes, but our editor-in-chief works with editors that are global because we're a global brand. We have editors that are based in London, they're based in Hong Kong, they're based in Sydney, they're based in San Diego, and they're not all here in our New York office. So we track everything through Jira. So our editor-in-chief uses Jira to not only create their editorial calendar for the month, which they create early on, and they start to track all the different stories that they have planned for the upcoming month. They add all of their Word docs into Jira for each story when they're tracking it. And our editor-in-chief likes to use this and define the process as the editors go of how the editors are going to work together. Again, just so all the editors follow the same process. We don't want different editorial teams doing different things. We like to try to stay to the grid if we can. And they've created this process in Jira where they have an article that goes into draft mode. They don't do this all directly through our CMS. Sometimes they like to just do it all through Word docs. So we have a shared Google Doc that they like to use. But we're tracking all this through Jira. And they can actually track when the articles have been drafted, when they've been approved, when they're edited, when they're up on WordPress, which is our CMS, and when things are published. And again, it's a nice way to keep track of things, not only in our CMS where the articles live and where they're published, but we also have a record of these things being defined early on, so we have a head start on which stories are being created. And our sales team that has access to Jira loves this because they can see early on what's coming for the month, which kind of acts as our editorial calendar. They're actually going in and looking at new articles that are being researched, things that our journalists have been working on for months sometimes and planning ahead. So it's a nice way for everyone to keep track and stay in tune with each other, having everyone work in the same tool set. But I think this is a nice example of you really want to keep all of your business units not only having specific workflows, but in the same tools if possible. Any
just
questions
just
on that before we move forward? Yeah.
We do have a couple of questions. One question specifically on the editorial example. How was the uptake with the editors when this was implemented?
I think for initially, I think the expectation is probably exactly what everyone thinks. They hated it, actually. They were like, oh man, now we have to use this other tool. Like we were doing stuff and tracking things on, you know, Google Doc and spreadsheets. And I think the problem for us was we have a lot of brands. We have a lot of editorial teams. So we have a lot of magazines that are under the Strategic Insight umbrella. They're geolocated, and it's really hard to keep teams working in tune. We want people to work following a same streamline. We don't want people to do their own thing. And some people tracking on docs. And I think part of the problem for us was we went through a scenario about a year and a half ago where one of our brands, no names to any of these brands, lost a lot of its key players. Editor-in-chief left to a competitor, went with a lot of his staff as well. They were all really tight. And they all kind of left at once, and it left a big hole in our planning cycle because no one really knew how they did it. They had their own little method of doing things through Google Docs. It was their shared documents. Some of it is not company documents, which is stuff to look out for security. And we find by keeping everyone in the same process in a unified tool, regardless of people coming and going and editors leaving and moving on, it's a nice way to keep things moving on that conveyor belt because it's a defined process that everyone's going to follow. So we want our editors to use Jira. I think initially it took them a few weeks to, again, just to learn how to use it. Again, because we make it as simplified as possible, you know, we've really minimized the amount of fields and things that they have to fill out. We try to make it simple, basically just a minimum fields, give it a subject line, give it a little bit of a description, and then you could add in, you know, your Word docs that get drafted and things. And they're basically just putting on links to different documents. But it definitely was a little bit of a transition period, but the long term of this effect has been very, very positive because through Jira we can generate a lot of metrics and not only on how frequent they're being completed and when they're being completed and putting these things on screens. We had a couple people visit our office here. And for anyone who knows me, we have TV screens around our office where we show our boards, and it rotates through them in JIRA. And we really like that. That way there's a lot of transparency to our editorial backlog. People know when things are coming. There's, you know, we try to keep it as visible as possible. And I think the transparency group to group was really the positive effect of, you know, a lot of people know now what editorial is working on, what they've got coming, and yeah, that's been a really, really good thing for us.
Justin, a couple more questions on this. How did you handle versioning? Google Docs handled this pretty well. How do you actually handle versioning versus a bunch of files in a JIRA ticket?
We do, and actually just to clarify that, so the editors still use Google Docs for a lot of their editing because they're obviously keen to using, you know, digital documents as opposed to using JIRA to write the ticket. But they're using JIRA to track the links, right? So I have a link in each ticket to the Google Doc, and that's how they're actually editing it because the editors still choose to use Google Docs to link to these things. But it's nice to have a record of it. And I think in terms of versioning, you know, the editors do their own versioning through Word Online, like the shared Google Doc version where you can actually go in and edit in line and add comments and things. So they are still using standard documents for the actual content, but we're using JIRA to track, you know, how many articles there are per issue, things like that. Like we have one ticket for each article. And it's also a nice way to keep track of all the research. So I know that was a positive take from one of our editors that they brought to me of beforehand our editors did their own research. You know, they kind of had their own method of doing this. But now we can go to these tickets and sometimes go back in time and look at what kind of research we completed on certain articles and attach those documents here. And it's become a nice repository for editorial research. And in that aspect, it's been very helpful because I can, you know, for the other editors to go back again for editors that are no longer here and see how they completed their research. Everything should be attached to these tickets. It's where we keep all of our documentation. Does that make sense?
All right, great.
Yeah.
Definitely. And one more question before we move on to another slide. This question's a little more general. Justin, are you the person who sits with the business units to create the workflow and then set it up in JIRA?
I do, yes. And actually, sometimes each group, like our marketing team, has their own little workflow. It's very similar to this, though, that, you know, it's just different labels. So typically, they'll take a crack initially at what they want the process to be. Sometimes I get napkin drawings or just whiteboards. And then I'll usually help them refine it if I see anything in there, like that example before, which I said was probably a bad example of, you know, we don't want to include too many steps. We don't want to overcomplicate it. We do want to keep it simple. Sometimes I win and lose that battle, but you know, for the most part, they create an initial draft, and then I help them refine it because I know the tool better, I suppose.
All right, great. We can move on.
Yep, feel free to move on. All right, so some common mistakes I see when using tools like this, and this is one that came up this week. I think Lady and I were chatting about this, so I added this slide in. I thought as a bonus slide. So one of the caveats for me about using tools like this is reporting, right? It's all about reporting. That's the whole point of all of this is I wouldn't want it in any of these tools if I couldn't report on it because it's really not about not only creating the process and having tools define the process, but I need to show some sort of metric to our executive management here that what we're doing now is better or more efficient or anything like that. I need to have metrics to support what we're doing. So in JIRA, I always like the example of use native dashboards in JIRA, right? Not more tools, right? I don't want to use more third-party business intelligence tools and start exporting data and importing data. And I really am not a fan of using Excel to create metrics, even though that's the easiest way to do it and everyone's familiar with it. I'm not a fan of any of that, personally. And I also don't like to separate projects in JIRA unless necessary. And I think this is one that is a really good – we could probably do a whole meeting just on this topic. But the example I have here is that we have many brands under our Strategic Insight umbrella. And sometimes people make a common mistake of saying, well, each brand has their own bucket, right? A separate quote-unquote project in JIRA, maybe. In which case, every team has their own separate queue, which is fine. But it really hurts the ability to report on that if everybody's separate. So we make the decision here at our company to keep certain things in a single project in JIRA, and we use something called components in JIRA to handle variations in requests so that I can track on it. So on the right side, my example here is we have 12 brands under the Strategic Insight umbrella. All of them are, some of them are very unique in terms of the work they do, but they're all publishing brands one way or the other. And I need to produce a metric to show how much work our development team is doing towards one brand or the other, or how much work our development team is doing versus one business unit or the other, which is what I've got here. So in one project in JIRA, everybody submits tickets into this one project, which seems like it's a busy project, and it is. We have a lot of tickets that go through this queue. But if I do it this way, I'm able to create a metric like this. Right now I can actually create, use native JIRA and their native dashboards that are built with the tool, right? There's no extra cost to this stuff, and produce a dashboard like this that shows me exactly how many tickets we have for each brand year to date, and how much I can split that up for each brand individually or each business unit. And these metrics go such a long way for us month over month, year over year, to measure productivity, right? Of how many tickets are we completing in a certain time? You know, what's the scope of these tickets? Which business unit are they for? And for me, these are only, you can only produce metrics like this if you have things combined into a single project, right? Whether you're on Rally or on time, it's really all the same concept for me of sometimes you want to make smart decisions on separating workflows and keeping them together. Does that make sense? Right. This instance here is really maintenance. This is our development maintenance queue. So we have all of our brands submit tasks to our developers, and we prioritize them, and we do sprint planning sessions and the whole, all that jazz. But producing this metric can only be done by keeping them in a single bucket. If I had them all in separate buckets or separate projects in JIRA, I can only produce this by bringing that data outside of JIRA and through a different tool or a spreadsheet. Jump
just
ahead, Matt.
I'll just chime in for a second. So we're doing that here at North Star. We had already set up in JIRA different projects, and Lydia's on the call with us, who she's run the PMO office. And it's hard now for us to create this kind of simple graph because we have so many different projects broken out. Travel Weekly maintenance, meetings and conventions website maintenance. So we're using a plug-in to Smartsheets, where we're creating kind of a similar Uber dashboard to just see at a high level what's the volume of work that's coming through. So that's always an option too. Probably not the best, but I love what you're talking about. Thank you.
Yeah, and that what you just said, we didn't set this up, right, Roberta? But that's like the perfect segue into my next slide here if you want to jump ahead, Matt. Okay. So plugins is an easy way to solve this problem, right? Because it's a nice way when you're using other systems. You say, oh, well, we don't, you know, Smartsheet is a good one. We do that here as well. And personally, I'm not a fan of Smartsheet because it's cost, right? The whole point here is you've got to save on cost. And sometimes you have companies that are able to do this and, you know, can just buy licenses for some other tool, and that suffices for now. But I think something to consider if you've got a development team in hand and if you have a backlog of work that you can build on, of my recommendation is to only use plugins when necessary if you really need to, and instead to utilize an API, which is from the technology side how I would connect any two systems together, because a plugin will always be defined by rules, right? They're telling you how you want these systems to link together, and they're making a general idea of how we think companies do this. But every company is so unique. Like usually when I start using plugins, it always has some blocker or get you halfway there, and sometimes that works. But if you have a development team and you have software that's enterprise level like JIRA or Salesforce or Smartsheet, there are APIs available where developers can plug this in and customize the solution exactly the way your company needs it to work. And I like the Salesforce example here of, you know, consider when you have tools like JIRA and Salesforce in play, consider data syncs between platforms to avoid confusion, you know, via APIs as an alternative method to keeping everyone in sync, and save on cost because you pay for each user to access JIRA and you pay for each user to access Salesforce. These are extraordinarily expensive tools, actually. I mean, Salesforce is the most expensive thing under the sun. So to avoid license costs and to avoid those kind of increases, my recommendation is with an API, you can connect these tools. So in the example here, I've got through our API, right, through no paid plugin, we've connected Salesforce and JIRA. And all I do is basically take Salesforce tasks. So when someone creates a task in Salesforce, it creates one in JIRA. That way I don't need salespeople necessarily to have access to both of these systems because that's a lot of extra money. I just want them to be able to create the task in Salesforce, have it appear here in JIRA, and when tasks get completed, I want to notify Salesforce that update was completed, and the salesperson doesn't have to leave Jira. I mean, doesn't have to leave Salesforce because that's their world, and our developers don't have to leave Jira because that's their world, and they can work together efficiently without going back and forth. And you can see here, maybe it's really kind of small detail, but in the example below, we've got all of our synced tasks on our Jira board, which is basically just tasks in Salesforce. But on the right side, you can see I've also synced up where it says labels. It's a Salesforce ID number. So I can click on that and actually go to Salesforce. Right? There's some syncing of records. And that's another nice way just to keep things in sync over time. You know, sometimes I like to have that linkage on tasks and see when things in Jira are connected with things in Salesforce. But we have our sales team working like this. I thought that was an interesting model that people would want to see here. I don't think many people do this, but for us, we want to keep everyone locked into these tools and not use other things, and we do that all through APIs with the software. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's actually interesting because we've been thinking about you know, how do we manage the large volume of email that comes through? Like everybody requests to have their client email or their marketing email go out on a certain date because we're centralized, we're a central service. So it would be interesting if I started the request for a date in Salesforce because that's where the salespeople are hanging out, and I linked it to the Jira ticket, and maybe that started the workflow. But that's a good thing to think about.
Yep. Exactly, yeah. And you can set off notifications for those things both in Jira and Salesforce so you can have people emailed and pinged when you want them to be pinged so you're not overwhelming people with emails, right?
Right.
And I know I'm a little over my time here, so I'll breathe through the last few here. I think there's only a few slides left if you want to jump ahead, Matt. Or maybe there's only two left. So obviously, you know, everything we've talked about here, workflow is a really fundamental part of succeeding with any tool out there. You know, coming up with the workflow is the hard part, you know, just step one. But having you know, a tool that helps reinforce that really, really does go a long way. And my recommendation really is to listen to your employees' pain points. I think the example below is great, that you know, you want to help people understand why what they're doing might be inefficient and how there might be a better way of doing this. Because when people work together, we have more fun, we get stuff done, right? Who doesn't want to be a part of that? And I think that, you know, for me, having tools like Jira and having worked with these kind of things over the years, it really makes a difference in day-to-day activities, and it really makes a difference in people working well together, especially when you're not sitting next to each other. So, you know, I hope what we've shared here gives people a little bit to think about in terms of the way that your teams are working together and how they should, you know, find some tools to help define their process.
Yeah. We just started thinking, too, about, you know, sometimes ads don't serve right, or they're, you know, the takeover, or, you know, they're just something's going wrong on the website. And, you know, normally just a ticket comes into the help desk and, you know, all holy hell breaks loose with 82 emails, you know, with salespeople screaming. But we're actually now setting up a very specific, you know, digital ad operations workflow where it's specifically meant to not only just track when there's issues with ad, you know, there's ad problems, display ad issues, but there's also, you know, when you build a new website, the whole testing just around making sure all the ads get served to the right section, to the right page, make sure they're not breaking things, if they're pushdowns or flyovers or whatever, that we've created a whole workflow for that too. So good things to think about.
Yeah, and I think that kind of goes in line with what we've got here. The process evolves, right? It changes over time. I would never expect to get it right the first time, actually. And when you have the right tools in place, you can just modify it as you go. I think that's the whole point, right?
All right, great. Thanks, guys. We had asked a couple DMC members to chime in on this conversation, specifically James Arnold, VP of Digital at Farm Journal. James is actually going to circle back to the discussion around the whole digital media and ad ops structure. So James, if you're with us, I know Bernadette Malman had to jump off to another meeting, but James, if you're with us, you can unmute your line, hit *7, and just get your take on this as well, please.
Well, I think, you know, we were looking at it. You can hear me all right, Matt?
Yes.
We were looking at it over the past couple of years. We had tried different approaches. We took some of our ops management and had it managed corporately across, you know, our entire operation. We had our order entry sort of managed corporately. And what we saw was we thought it would be best to have digital people dealing with all things digital. So we went to the pod structure with that concept in mind, where we would take the digital people and manage the workflow, but it would all be within people who were part of the digital team. And so we rolled out these customer success teams with the customer success manager sort of being that digital sales expert working right alongside the salespeople. They know the accounts, they know the clients, they know the RFP decisions that have been put into place so they can help optimize. From there, I think one of the things that maybe was glazed over that we found great success with is we incentivized the teams completely based on campaign delivery. And so it's the accountability part was I think maybe our big win here, because the whole team was then held accountable and bonus based on their success of the team. So if they delivered at 98%, they were bonused in a certain way. If they all delivered, they all worked well together and got to 100%, they were bonused differently. I think that was a key part of our success. I'll tell you about that in a sec. But while we cross-trained everybody on the teams, we allowed for specialization. So there's that locus of control that employees want, that people want. They want to have that thing that they control. They know what they're supposed to do every day. But we cross-trained them so everybody knew how to do everything. We just made sure there was still expertise to be had. And so where'd we go? We did research within our own sales force, and boy, that's always scary to ask sales reps what they think. But we got a confidence rating from our operation of about 3 out of 5, maybe even a little lower than that. And that was last year. And when we implemented this whole pod approach in May, did that same study, and we had already jumped a point in 2 months. So the confidence was now 4 out of 5. They saw the value. Plus, on the bonus side, the accountability side, each month, each of our teams has achieved a bonus, and each of those teams has achieved 100% at one point or another. So bringing everything digital into digital, and creating a team structure and sort of bonusing them based on their group success has sort of been our win. Now it's funny, we're talking about operational structures and success because we still feel like we're not ever going to be there, but we feel like at least we got a win, a little win here.
And who's on your pod? Like, what makes your pod up? That'd be good to know.
Right. So you look in the lower right here, we have three basic structures, three basic silos. We have a crops pod, we have a livestock pod, we have a produce pod. And so within those structures, we have a customer success manager, mm-hmm. and then based on volume, we'll have customer success specialists.
Right.
And, you know, one success specialist may be the database guru who knows all of our livestock, how to pull cattle out of our database. Another person might be ad ops for the site, and another person might be, you know, the reporting engine. You know, those as an expertise, but they're cross trained, so they all know how to do everything. Should somebody go on vacation,
all right,
they do that.
They do go on vacation. Yes,
it's annoying, but they do.
That's great. Anybody else have any questions? I'm excited because, you know, it's good to hear that Farm Journal's actually kind of gone down this path already and seen success. So I think it's very encouraging for us at North Star. For sure.
Quick success. It was we're all pretty thrilled.
Yeah.
We turned the corner on something that was sort of a negative for some time.
Did you have to sell the pod concept to, you know, during the budget process, because in order for you to maybe, you know, you have to set up that first pod and everybody has a day job at the same time. So normally there is some, I guess, hiring of new people before you can actually start to break everybody into a pod. You know, did you have any trouble selling that in the beginning during the budget season because your costs were going up?
Internally, it was mostly a shift of cost, but where there was budget that had to be added, it wasn't a hard sell because it was an understood lack of confidence mm-hmm. from our sales force. And once you have that, you perk up the ears of all the people who want revenue. And so it really wasn't a hard sell. And the pod concept was so, it seemed after we put it together, so obvious that, yeah. that it wasn't really all that hard.
Right.
Hey, this is Reggie. Just adding in my two cents, I think it's great that you guys have verticalized based off of, you know, your different sort of silos here, crops, produce, and adding in that incentive feature will definitely motivate. I've seen it work at other companies, and it, you know, it's a great motivator for sure. So kudos to you guys.
It's a little amount of money, but, man, they are firebrand about it. They just want after that little amount of money. So it's paid off for sure.
Great. Thanks for sharing. All right. Anybody else want to chime in or jump in before we wrap up with what's going on around Connectiv? Or got a burning question?
Hey, Roberta, this is Bob West over at Meister Media. I guess I have a question I would direct to you guys, for any of you. You've talked about building these pods with digitally focused individuals, which I think makes sense. I guess our question would be, how do you go about finding such people who are digitally focused?
Right, yeah. So I know for North Star, we first created the job descriptions. You know, after we went through the chart where we knew what responsibilities each individual would have, we then created campaign manager job descriptions. And, you know, they were very focused on digital expertise. And we started using, I want to say, Aquint talent search, or Vitamin T was one of them that seems to always have a lot of digitally focused individuals. And then for the account managers, same thing, focused the job description a lot around digital and trying to make sure when we pre-screen people, they have to know what a website is, and they have to, you know, there's certain criteria they have to meet before we even bring them in for an interview. Anybody else want to jump on that question?
I'll add on to it. I think definitely looking internally as well. You know, you have people that are currently working on your sites, just building them up, sending them out to different training sessions and other, you know, knowledge-based sessions, and then kind of giving them the opportunity to reconstruct their role. And, you know, that would probably get you a good, solid start, and then also gives you the opportunity to look, like Roberta said, outside of the company for other skillful people.
Right. Like if we outsource all of the ad serving, right? So that means I have three people already where a large chunk of their work comes off their plate. So they're ready to now move into the campaign management role with some training, and they have the background knowledge of all of our brands and all of our technology. Any other questions? Okay, great. Matt, you want to go on to what's going on around Connectiv?
Absolutely. Well, thanks again, everybody. I think this has been a terrific conversation, and thank you to Roberta and Reggie, Justin and James. I know we went a little over, but I think it was worth it. Just in terms of some upcoming events you guys might want to take notice of, I know we're going to be seeing many of you next week at the Business Information and Media Summit. Look forward to seeing you there. On November 29th, we've got a webinar on finding hidden revenue by monetizing existing content, basically how you can use some third-party services to turn content that's already been published in your magazines, on your websites, and your newsletters, turn that into content marketing pieces and really monetize stuff that's already out in your system. And then wrapping up the year, December 4th and December 5th, we're going to be having two separate flights for the Connectiv Revenue Committee meeting in New York City. We have two different flights. so we can have non-competitive companies come together and really talk about some of the issues. This really speaks to the people who are in charge of revenue, so whether that's salespeople, chief revenue officers, anybody directly involved in generating revenue is welcome. And if you're interested in attending, you can certainly reach out to me, and we're happy to put you in the appropriate session there. And with that, I think that concludes our meeting today. I thought this was a terrific conversation. Thank you again. Thank you again to the audience for your participation. This has been recorded, and I'll follow up with the presentation deck and also the archive. And then I believe our next meeting is going to be in January as well. Correct, Roberta?
I think so. Yep.
All right. Terrific. So I'm sure I'm going to be talking to some of you before then. But if not, happy holidays, and we'll connect again in January.
Great. Take care, guys. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.